conditionally always think about this interaction between climate forcing and also human impacts. And over the last 30, 40 years, also we try to include impacts of like disturbance, like fires and windstorms. And we think, yeah, I'm sure that all these things are affecting forest dynamics in different spatial scales. And today, I would like to show you some of the updated information about all these things using some examples. And particularly in terms of human impacts on forests, or forest landscape, particularly in Europe, would be very useful for most of you. So we use, or I use, fossil pollen, is that in lake sediment or bogs. And we go to lakes and bogs to get sediment cores from bottom of these places and analyze pollen grains. And so, of course, different species produce different amount of pollen grains, and also different pollen types can be transported by wind in a different distance because of differences in size, weight, and shape. So, generally, paleoecologists use pollen percentage values to describe changes in vegetation, but in reality, it is hard to estimate what these pollen percentage values mean in terms of plant cover. And I have developed a kind of scheme for reconstructing past vegetation using fossil pollen data. So this is called landscape reconstruction algorithm. And because pollen grains are transported by wind the long distance, so we have to think about, at first, what would be the regional vegetation, for example, within 50 kilometer radius from your site, and how much of this regional vegetation would contribute to your pollen proportion, or pollen assemblages. And I developed a model of reviews to use that to reconstruct the regional vegetation composition first, and next step is to estimate vegetation composition within much smaller scale, like landscape scale or local scale, using this information about regional vegetation. And so this model is called LAM model, local vegetation estimate. So today I'm going to show some of the very recent results using this reviews model in Europe and also part of North America also. So over the last 10 years, we have been working together with people from different countries in Europe to estimate changes in vegetation cover in many parts of Europe. Not pollen proportions, but vegetation cover based on the model I developed. And so this example shows the differences in vegetation development in four different regions. And so this is the average value for all these four different regions. And we have been interested in how much human impacts have changed the landscape. So this figure shows changes in the percentage cover of grassland and percentage cover of arable land in four different regions we estimated. And so this vertical scale is in terms of age, so it is 12,000 years ago, 10,000 years ago, and so on. And around 4,000 years ago, many places, many parts of Europe have changed quite dramatically in terms of percentage cover. So apparently, human impacts became more intensified after 4,000 years ago in many parts of Europe. So, and also we estimated vegetation cover in different parts of Europe, in this case, 1 degree by 1 degree scale. And where we have pollen data available, we reconstructed regional vegetation through time, and in this case, using 5 different time windows. So this figure shows vegetation cover of grassland and agricultural land about 6,000 years ago. And so this color scheme shows darker, much widely, be occupied by these types. So this is 6,000 years ago. So just look at. So about 3,000 years ago, so you can see changes in pattern of color. And about 200 years ago, and today, or over the last 100 years. So, and this is spruce. So about 6,000 years ago, so this is a reconstructed vegetation cover of spruce. About 3,000 years ago, so now you can see the shift of this spruce coverage. And 500 years ago, 200 years ago, and over the last 100 years. And so this is the shade in Korean summer green trees. So 6,000 years ago, 3,000, 500, 200, and over the last 100 years. And so this is Arisax or shade tolerant summer green. And so 6,000 years ago, so here you can see the pattern. And about 3,000 years ago, pattern changed and much less abundant than before. 500 years ago, 200 years ago, and over the 100 years. So all these patterns show how much human impacts have affected this forested landscape in many parts of Europe. And also, now of course traditionally we know that human impacts are very important to understand changes in vegetation in the past. But also, recently we tried to kind of quantify how much these human impacts have been contributing to changes of vegetation in relation to climate, for example. Climate change always affects the vegetation abundance and species composition. So, for example, in Estonia, so we use these data sets. So we have used pollen data from around 19 sites. And so over the last about 5,000 years, we estimated pollen-based regional vegetation using the reviews model, and also using climate variables independently obtained from different sources to compare how these changes in vegetation could be attributed to changes in climate. And also, we have certain indices which show impact of human. So, and using the variance partitioning, so this is a statistical method, to estimate how much variation was explained, how much variation changes in vegetation composition are explained by like these two variables, by human impact of climate. So using data set for over entire 5,000 years. So this is a pattern people we found. So even though it's not big, but and human impacts are of course fairly big. But at least now we are able to attribute how much of these changes in vegetation could be explained by these two factors. And using we found that about 4,000 or 4,500 years ago, impact of climate, or impact of human activity, became almost as important as climate on vegetation composition and spatial patterns of vegetation in Estonia. So using same technique, so we use data set from different parts of Europe, and on average, so we use all the data sets together. So this is the pattern we have, we found. So this axis is from 8,000 years ago to today. And this blue curve shows the variation explained by climate changes through time. So about 8,000 years ago, about 80% of variation found in vegetation is explained by climate, but this climate influence has become smaller and smaller and smaller. And about 4,000 years ago, probably in many parts of Europe, the human impacts as well as the interaction between human and climate impacts became much more important, or almost as important as climate itself. So, and also in sediments, we can find some evidence of disturbances like fires, because we can find many small particles of charcoal fragments in sediments. So by analyzing these charcoal fragments, we are able to show some patterns of fire behavior, And so this is a kind of global or subcontinental scale study on this fire level. And so now I'm going to show you results from two regions, from North America, very large region, and Western Europe. So this figure shows so this is the time from 12,000 years ago to today. And this y-axis in this part shows standardized charcoal index. And so this red curve and blue curve shows changes in standardized charcoal indices. So using different filters. And this orange curve shows estimated changes in temperature on average, but not really by the picture. So in this case, anomaly means how much different from today. Not the absolute value, but how much different from today. So North America as a whole, so this changes in temperature is fairly smooth. And also when you look at changes in fire levels, or charcoal levels, it's almost 1-to-1. Only very recent past, this pattern breaks down. However, in Europe, so this is the estimated. So this is the estimated of standardized charcoal index. Much more the differences, and R square is lower than in North America. So this is clearly showing more heavier impacts of human activities. And in regional changes, also using charcoal abundance in sediments. So this is an example from Scandinavian or Fennoscandia. So this figure shows, so this line shows the Thysa Aegis, a kind of Lengi River. So about 10,000 years ago, Thysa Aegis was more abundant, the Lengi limit was up to here. And about 8,000 years ago, Lengi limit expanded westward, and about 3,000 years ago, so this was the Lengi limit. So Lengi limit is moving, or has been moving. And so this figure shows changes in charcoal abundance in individual time window, and time window. So the shape of this triangle shows it becomes smaller or becomes larger in terms of the charcoal abundance. So you can see some patterns. And this figure shows a kind of summary of this, but you can standardized charcoal abundance in the time window. So this is time window from 10,000 years ago, 8 to 10,000 years ago. And so this is the charcoal index. And most eastern part of this Fennoscandia, about 10,000 years ago or later, spruce increased. And abundance of charcoal becomes previous time windows. And this Fennoscandia pattern is slightly different after spruce increase, but still there are some patterns. And southern coast of the abundance did not change much in terms of spruce became more abundant. So clearly, fire regimes are related to certain changes in vegetation and some cases. And another example, so this is local landscape scale changes in fire. So this is an example of North America, so which is the place also, Big Lake also studied, so we were together, you were 20 years ago. And so using this data set from this area, so this is the old growth forest, the dominated by or characterized by hemlock and sugar maple. And we've established four permanent plots. And so this is one of the plots, and every tree is mapped. And so in this case, red dot represents sugar maple, Acer saffron, and green dot represents Sena canadensis, hemlock. And we found that these two small sites called small forest forests, these are just like small depression forests. And using pollen data, I estimated changes in stem type over 100 years using these two small forest forests. And so this part shows changes in charcoal concentration, charcoal concentration. So after hemlock increase, fire was very rare, but at least there were two occasions. And the sites are only 150 meters away, but still we can see that. But the interesting thing is here, after fire, at the border of this hemlock and sugar maple stem, it became sugar maple stem, but later it becomes also hemlock stem. So there is a kind of back and forth movement sugar maple and hemlock, most likely caused by fire. But other kind, two kinds, we have these changes, but there are no clear increase in charcoal fragments. And most likely these are caused by wind snow, but wind snow is a very hard to estimate in pollen data. And so using this kind of idea of changes in storminess, also, I have started a new project last year trying to estimate how much these storminess have changed through time. And so using sediments and using differences in size distribution of mineral particles in sediment, people have estimated changes in storminess using when the size of grains of mineral particles becomes larger, that would indicate strong storm period. And when size distribution becomes much smaller, skewed to smaller particles, for example, these periods, these are relatively quiet or calm, quiet period in terms of storms. So using these things from sediment in southern part of Sweden, people have estimated. So these are the period, so this is the time from 6,000 years ago to today. And so these are the time period, most likely storm was more stronger or more frequent. So using this idea, so I started this project for example. So using the sediments from Estonia, particularly in this case, the northern part of this island called Hiiumaa. And so this is a LiDAR image of our study site. So you can see very clearly formed a kind of sand dune beaches over the last 4,000 years because of land uplift. And using this profile, so we set up this transect. And so this is a topography profile along this transect. And so in this area, using ground-penetrating radar, so we try to estimate how the stratigraphy of sands underground have changed. And so just we found this kind of seawall tilted layers of different sand types. So this shows the signs of very strong storms. And using this technique, we estimated along this transect, so these are the time periods of strong storminess and relatively quiet period. So now we are trying to date how old these ridges are. In addition, also we obtain these sediments from large bog nearby. So we try to estimate grain size changes in grain size of mineral particles to show different how these things results would match to what we found so far. And also using pollen data to reconstruct past vegetation. So these forcing records of vegetation would be very informative for forest ecology, I hope, to understand how the changes in disturbance regimes interfere with vegetation. Thank you.